Welcome to the Eye of Truth. For several thousands of years, humanity has studied what occurs in our world in an attempt to reveal the regularity behind it all. Over time, our methods have changed from astrology and other kinds of ancient divinity to modern science, that is, the natural sciences. Disciplines such as mathematics, physics, and chemistry have revealed to us the logic behind many natural phenomena. And the regularity of the logic behind these phenomena means that we can even predict what has yet to happen. Over just the past several hundreds of years, we have gone from wondering why an apple falls from a tree to taking our first steps into areas such as the theory of relativity, quantum mechanics, and superstring theory. So why is it that some physicists in their old age begin to believe in a god or creator, and theories that seem related to theology and religion? These would seem to be the exact opposite of science, at first glance. Why do scientists make such a sudden change in thinking as they age? Theology is the end point of science. Is this really true? In this video, I take a look at science and theology. I'm not here to preach, and I hope you'll stick around to the end. I'll start by introducing several famous physicists who are also religious. Some modern physicists, including Isaac Newton, the father of classical mechanics, Johannes Kepler, the astrophysicist who proposed what are now known as Kepler's laws, Michael Faraday and James Clerk Maxwell, leading figures in the field of electromagnetics, were all deeply religious. Many other of their lesser-known contemporaries were also religious. There is a simple reason why so many scientists back then were deeply religious. It's because they were living in an age where religion was a daily part of life. What about modern physicists? You might be surprised to hear that 65% of the recipients of the Nobel Prize in Physics from 1901 to 2000 believed in some sort of religion. For example, the recipient of the 1918 Nobel Prize in Physics was Max Planck, an instrumental figure in the field of quantum mechanics and a firm believer in the existence of a creator. Another example is Chen-Ning Yang, a theoretical physicist who received the 1957 Nobel Prize in Physics for his parity symmetry violation theory, and who began to believe in a creator in his old age. However, for these scientists, this creator is less like the human-like gods of mythology and legend, and more like a natural force that created our world. This might be hard to understand, so let's watch a brief clip of Yang speaking at a symposium.
如果你问我说是有没有上帝呢？如果你所谓的上帝是一个人形状的，那我想没有。如果你问我说是有没有一个造物者，那我想是有的。因为整个这个世界的结构不是偶然的。看了这个麦克尔方程是这么妙不可言，不可能是偶然的，偶然你不能搞出来这么妙的这个东西。在20岁的时候，我会对于
Let's consider what Yang said here. If what he said is true and there is a creator, then the birth and existence of our universe was not a coincidence, but instead the creation of some kind of consciousness. That consciousness is the creator that both Planck and Yang were thinking of. There is a law of physics called the second law of thermodynamics. This law explains how entropy increases. Unless there is some outside interference, a system will not change from a state of chaos to a state of order. Imagine taking all the parts of a wristwatch and placing them in a cup. Even if this cup was stirred for several hundred millions of years, the parts would never become a highly ordered watch. Consider the smartphone you use every day. Even if given more than a billion years, the chemical and physical reactions that occur in nature would not cause all the parts of a smartphone to be spontaneously created, collected, and assembled into a single smartphone. In other words, highly ordered things like watches and smartphones only exist because they were made through the conscious process of creation. A living thing is tens of thousands of times more complicated than something like a smartphone. Modern science and technology tell us that the living thing with the simplest structure is a virus. However, even if we were given all the raw materials of a virus, we would be unable to create one from scratch. It is therefore very difficult to believe that a living thing could be created coincidentally through the various reactions that occur in nature. Scientists have an even deeper understanding of this than your typical person, so it stands to reason that some scientists believe in a creator. I want to stress once more that the creator being discussed in this video is not the kind of human-like deity discussed in mythology and religion. The creator discussed in this video is the force or consciousness that created our world and universe. Many people probably don't realize this, but the birth and existence of our universe is more mysterious than any miracle. For example, the recipient of the 2020 Nobel Prize in Physics, Roger Penrose, once said the following about the creation of the universe. The possibility of a single black hole universe, where the entire universe is a black hole, being created by the Big Bang, is 10 to the 300th power times more likely than the creation of our current universe. That is, even if there were 10 to the 300th power Big Bangs, only one of them would result in the creation of our universe. In other words, if this is correct, then that means that the Big Bang has occurred at least 10 to the 300th power times. Therefore, there may be other universes similar to ours. I plan to discuss this topic in a video about parallel worlds. Next, let's consider how likely it is that a universe similar to our own would exist. The various physical formulas that describe the laws of physics contain unchanging values called physical constants. In our universe, these constants are exactly what they must be in order for our world to exist in its current form. However, if the constants in even one of these countless formulas was different, our world would not only take a very different shape, but the very atoms that make up matter here might not exist. Even if the Big Bang creates a universe that is not a black hole universe, it does not necessarily mean that planets and life would exist in that universe. In other words, the possibility of our universe being created and existing through sheer coincidence is close to zero. It is for this reason that some physicists, when confronted with this, begin to believe that the universe was created by some consciousness, or a creator. Of course, the creator theory is not the only way of considering the universe. One example is the anthropic principle, a theory that argues that the universe is suited for humans precisely because we would be unable to observe it if that were not the case. The parallel world theory, too, is just one of many interpretations. Our universe is special in how unlikely it was to be created and to exist. However, it is due to the countless parameters involved with the Big Bang that a special universe like our own is possible. Next, I'll talk a little bit about religion, which is closely connected with the topic of this video. Many religions have something in common. They all insist that our world began from a state of disorder or chaos. I believe that the concept of chaos described by these religions is an attempt to describe the state of singularity prior to the expansion of the Big Bang. There is a concept of ultimate reality in Buddhism, and this concept has been interpreted in many ways. One of the Buddhist texts on the topic of ultimate reality explains, "The trees and flowers exist only when observed, and otherwise are not there." This seems impossible within the mundane world in which we live. However, quantum mechanics tells us that particles at the microscale level exist in a probability state of uncertain location and speed when unobserved, and only converge into a defined state when observed. I believe that this passage in the Buddhist text was written to more easily explain existence at this microscale level to the people of that time. Similarly, if we keep an open mind, we can find many examples of Buddhist teachings explaining the laws of physics and astronomy. Of course, this has nothing to do with why some physicists come to believe in a creator. This is simply my personal thoughts on Buddhism. Let's get back to the topic of this video. Einstein once revealed that he did not believe in a God with human-like characteristics. However, he also said the following: "The human mind, no matter how highly trained, cannot grasp the universe. We are in the position of a little child, entering a huge library whose walls are covered to the ceiling with books in many different tongues. The child knows that someone must have written those books. It does not know who or how. It does not understand the languages in which they are written. If the ultimate goal of science is to understand everything in the universe, Einstein seems to believe that we'll never get there. I'd like to end this video with something Chen Ning Yang once said at a symposium. When I was young, I was full of confidence and I believed I could understand anything. However, as I got older, studying the universe only revealed to me how interesting and mysterious it really is. I believe that these words perfectly express the disappointment and sadness that many physicists begin to feel in old age. Thank you for watching.